fantastic or better. But in the off chance you're not and you're just feeling all right or okay, that's all right and okay. Well, not really. But hopefully by the time this little video of mine is over, you will be well on your way to feeling not bad, pretty good, amazing, awesome, splendid, fantastic, splendastic, or any of the infinite number of adjectives and adverbs to describe such an immense celestial feeling of pure and total bliss, which is just beyond human comprehension. I've never been able to make it that high myself. I usually can just barely get out of not bad. No, just kidding. Of course, we, you know, ups and downs all throughout our lives. Anyway, welcome to a video that I kind of did 2 years ago. So before we get into everything, the first thing I want to say is following this video, I will be doing a photography for beginners, ASMR style, obviously. For anyone getting into photography for the first time, or maybe you already take photos but are looking to understand things a little better, I'm not an expert. I know just enough where I can take the photos that I like. I'm not in the business of being a photographer full-time. I have the luxury because it's a hobby for me. And I'm not an expert at anything. I'm a jack of all trades, master of none. So I'm a mixed medium artist. I don't really have the patience or the brain. Maybe it's ADHD. I don't know. I enjoy a lot of different interests, whatever strikes my fancy at that time. Whatever my brain gets a hold of and triggers a strong dopamine, serotonin, adrenaline reaction to. That's what I go with. All right, so that's the first thing. Second thing is, the whole reason that we're here, and I kind of regret being here, but I don't have anything else planned for the video to take place of this video. I saw a comment about a week prior to this video, someone saying if I could do a video about my nature photography, something like that, I think. And I thought about it, and I was like, yeah, I don't think I ever did a video where I went over all the photos that I took back in 2022 when I acquired the Sony, I think it's a 200 to 600, or is it just the 600? No, it's a zoom. I think it's 200 to 600. Zoom lens. And that camouflage that you see is just a dust cover. Helps protect the actual coating in the lens itself. Anyway, so I picked that lens up April, May 2022 because I got hit with a strong interest and desire to photograph wildlife, birds. When I first got into photography in my 30s, and then, yeah, in my 30s, back around 2003, 2005, I was heavily obsessed with macro photography and seeing the close-up details of mostly bugs and insects, which I've always loved. throughout my life, even as a kid, but seeing the details you don't get to see every day. Microscope, telescope, you know, anything, x-rays, anything that lets you see just the things you don't normally get to see day to day with the naked eye, I guess. So that obsession lasted for a few years, and then that was it. So it's been like almost 20 years since I've done macro photography. Yeah, so this was the first, so spring of 2022 was the first time I got into photography not involving macro. So I had the zoom lens, and I had about three or four trips to a wildlife reserve and another, yeah, two different wildlife reserves or preserves. One was the John Heinz National Wildlife Refuge, located in Tinicum, Pennsylvania, near the Philadelphia airport. The other was Bombay Hook National Wildlife Refuge or Preserve, located in Delaware. So I already, as I prepped for this video, I forgot about the fact that I did a video like this back in June 2022, where I went over the first month's photos that I captured with the Sony 200-600 zoom lens, or 100-600, whatever. But I had a couple more trips after that, two or three more times, and then I basically saw every kind of bird, for the most part, besides any migrating birds that are not common to the area. And the passion died. So I went from the winter of 2022 to today, winter 2023-24, just one whole year of just giving up that hobby. But then I saw the comment, forgot about that video I already did, and I'm getting the itch again to, I think this spring I'll go back out and pick the hobby back up. I'm kind of feeling, I took a year off, and yeah, I just feel like I might get back out there. So if you have already seen the video that I did where I went over some of the first month of photos, I'm going to be going over them again. So kind of a repeat, but there are plenty of photos I didn't show. But if you're new here, then all of this will be new to you. All right, and I really hate doing the same thing over and over again. And I think that's it. So, it's, I don't know where you are across the world, but it's basically winter here in the northern hemisphere. Cold temperatures, especially, well, like I said, northern hemisphere, especially up north, United States, and obviously North Canada, everything. But I think Canada, anyway, I don't know much about Canada and their weather. But here on the East Coast, Mid-Atlantic region, it's cold. Everything is gray. The sky is blue sometimes, but the trees are dormant. Not much green foliage, so it's kind of bleh. And it's not very, I don't feel like going out and doing any photography. There's not much, you know, you can get the occasional cardinal or blue jay to add some color to the otherwise gray blahs. But yeah, I don't know. I just have no desire. And it's not because of the cold weather. I just, something about doing photography when everything is lush and green. So it's gonna go over the photos I've taken, and you'll see some things. The primary reason for this is besides the person suggesting it, but not so much, you know, look at my photos, but I just, you know, capturing some things we don't normally get to see. You know, these photos are no different than the photos anyone else has taken and that you'll find out there. And, you know, it's winter, and I just kind of, you know, looking at these photos here in winter just kind of is nice, and just makes me want to go out and take photos, and can't wait for spring to get here. And I think that's it. So why don't we get started? Alright, so again, these photos were all taken in 2022. They are all available at Flickr.com. I'm not here to promote Flickr, but that's where I put them. I should have them on my website, but I've been a little bit too lazy in trying to find a website gallery. I use WordPress. A little bit lazy to find a gallery, install it, blah blah blah. So I use Flickr, and it's free for the first 1,000 photos, I think. I paid for the pro, but anyway, won't get into all that. So all these photos are from 2022 and somewhat out of order. So this is at Bombay Hook National Wildlife Reserve, or NWR. And these, this is a crop of the actual photo. One good thing about the quality of some of the zoom lenses out there is that you can crop and basically zoom in on the digital image and get even closer to what the original image was that you captured. So here we have two male eagles. And again, I'm not really good with distance, but these were very far off. And you can see one in the top left is picking and eating at the carcass of something. Can't really see. And the other male eagle showed up. They had a little bit of a tassel, as the one that was eating kind of asserted his dominance. And then the other one just kind of waiting for the other eagle to finish. This was the first time I was able to ever see bald eagles. There's a lot of them at Bombay Hook in Delaware. There was like just half a dozen of them flying around. It's pretty cool, pretty crazy. So very fortunate and lucky to see that. Here is a great blue heron. These are like, well, all birds are dinosaurs, but when you look at this particular bird, I'm not sure what category it falls in besides bird, but it just looks like a dinosaur with the, basically its whole neck and its head is a biomechanical spear, right? So it's wading in the marsh. This is at the John Heinz NWR in Dinicum, Pennsylvania, which is a big marshy wetland area. So you can see the great blue heron wading there. It spots a fish, you know, stands still, starts to move its head closer slowly, and then it strikes down real quick. Lots of water spray there. I always like, I'm not sure if you're the same. I'm not sure if you are into photography. I'm assuming if you are here, you are somewhat, unless you're just here to chill and vibe. But I love capturing capturing the moments, the action, more than just the subject itself. I love capturing the behaviors. So I love watching, being able to use the camera to freeze time, basically, to capture the all the splashes and water droplets. And then you can see it's captured a fish just at the end of its beak, speared a fish, and it brings it up. I'm not sure what kind of fish that is. Don't ask me. A carp, some basic fish. All right, so now this is the interesting part. I don't think I've ever witnessed this before, but how does the heron get the fish and eat it down its beak, down its long neck? Well, it has to. Oh, I didn't catch that. There's another bird that I will show how it does it. But it has to flip the fish off its beak into the air and then grab it with its beak again and then eat it that way. So that's what I missed. That's what it did. There is the bird swallowing the fish. You can see how just swallowing it whole. I don't know how they can imagine trying to swallow a fish whole. I can't imagine what the inside of the bird's throat is like or made of to just do that without getting, scratched up and everything. I think this picture is a little out of order. You can see the fish tail. I'm not sure if you're watching this on your phone. So all these photos are going to be very small. I can't really zoom in too much. But if you're on your PC, you should be able to see them better. And so little fish tail kind of hanging out there. This is a ruby-crowned kinglet. I don't think I've shown these photos in that video I did back in around June 2022. No, I didn't. These birds are very cute and just puffy. I don't know. There's just something kind of adorable about them. This is why they're called the ruby crowned kinglet. They have a stripe of red on the top of their head right there. Some red feathers. And they showed up in a bunch. I think they were migrating. From what I understand, they migrate from the Canada region to Mexico. When I looked into it, I don't think they're common. I don't, there's a word for birds that don't migrate. I forget what they call that. I'm not sure if native is the word. I think there's another word, but I don't think these ruby-crowned kinglets are native permanent residents of the Mid-Atlantic region. I could be mistaken, but this is the first time I've seen them, and I was able to get somewhat fairly close to them. They weren't very timid. There was a whole bunch of them. Here's a nice profile. I always try to get the eye in the light, the sunlight. Even if it's the rest of the body is somewhat in the shade, so to speak. And this is just a picture of the bird as it was flying off the branch to fly away to another branch or something. Another picture, same bird. You can see the yellow striping on its black wings and the white around the eyes. Just perched up on a branch. Okay, this is a great egret, similar to the great blue heron, right? Yeah, great egret. Just perching, resting on a dead itself, standing on one leg. And, again, breeding egret. Your great egret. Can't forget the great. Don't ever insult them and call them just an egret. This is a barn swallow among the, I'm not sure, I don't know if you call these, I'm not sure what to call these. Not lily pads, I don't think. I feel like they're somewhat similar, but they grow out of the water. And so this particular barn swallow is just chirping away, and they are very difficult to photograph. They will often perch for a moment and then fly around the above water trying to catch insects. It's hard to, I've tried to photograph them in flight. It's difficult. Here is a close-up, a crop, so you can see some of the noise. That's just because of how much of a big crop it is of the original photo. So you can see it has like an iridescent kind of feathers on its top of its head and its back. Pretty neat. Almost different hues of blues, purple in there. Right? And then it has this kind of like just the, well, most birds do, I guess, but just the way their mouths, their beaks look when closed, almost give it an interesting, serious kind of expression. Okay, yeah, so bird feet down there, kind of a brownish orange coloring there, auburn on its face. Just a profile of the bird. Always try to make sure you know, get the eyes are sharp, but you can see here more of that kind of almost metallic looking feathers on the backside of the bird. Interesting. And this is a, what I believe is a yellow-rumped warbler. Because it has a yellow rump, I believe, on the back here, some yellow. I think this is a male. Usually male birds have all the color, the females black, any color. The reason I know the names of these birds is because I would come home after standing around for 3 hours, spending 3 hours, 3 to 4 of my mental energy, and then that's it for the day. I'm done. I'm usually good for 3 hours, 3 to 4 hours, creative mental energy, and then that's it. Anyway, so I would go on Google and type in small bird, yellow color on breast or something like that, and then you have to go through the photos. There's a website all about birds, I think, something like that, that has nothing but bird photos and identification. Great resource. So this is, I believe, a yellow-rumped warbler, and it is feeding on whatever type of seeds, whatever type of plant this is, and I'm absolutely clueless when it comes to plants. Here's just another side profile of the same bird. Very similar to the kinglet. It has these bands on the wing. don't think. The coloration is much different. Yeah, but, so I believe a yellow-rumped warbler. Here's a close-up crop you can see has a piece of seed in its beak right there. Another little close-up look of the freakish DNA that gives it the little spot of yellow. Interesting how evolution DNA works. Why is there just a yellow splotch here? Why not yellow splotches all over? You know, just interesting. Yep, there another close up. This is a crop again. I tried to denoise it as much as possible, but you can see it picking one of the seeds with its beak. This is kind of the photos that I like to see. I like to capture, and I like to see others capture as well. Another picture of trying to, this is probably the before. I think I'm going backwards. Yeah. If we go this way, yeah. So. Alright, another great egret. I think the photo earlier of the great egret was a great egret. There are also snowy egrets, which are smaller. So I might have been wrong, but it's an egret nonetheless. This is a prime kind of example of this particular egret, of the way it, of its neck bones, which is kind of just interesting, kind of fascinating. You know, it has a very long neck, but, you know, until you see it do this, you wouldn't know that its neck could bend like that. Must have a strong one neck bone here, and then maybe a neck bone there, and a series of joints that can make it curve like that. I don't know, just spitballing here. But yeah, just great egret. They're large birds out stalking for fish, frogs, small frogs, anything small. Just another, some droplets of water as it, after it unsuccessfully struck into the water. Just another view of its neck. So it looks like there's probably 1, 2, 3 bones here at work. One goes this way, and then it can bend here. Here it looks like 2 bones. I guess possibly 3. But then here, it definitely looks like 3 bones. Not sure if there's 1 bone here. Maybe there's just a bunch of smaller bones, so it can curve and bend. I don't know. Anyway, just guessing. So there's another prime example of the, just the length, how crazy the great egret's neck, and just, it's all meant to be a weapon, pretty much. And here it is, taking a look at whatever is down in the marsh. Okay, more ruby crowned kinglets. Again, this was taken in the fall 2022. This was pretty much the last time I went out. At this point, I captured almost everything you can. There's plenty of birds I didn't photograph. But by this time, October 2022, I was kind of, the hobby and the passion was, the fire was kind of dwindling. But yeah, just another ruby-crowned kinglet perching there on a branch. Here's a little better cropped close-up of that same kinglet, I believe. And you can see the some of the red in there. Red feathers. Here's a much better view there of all the red feathers in its top of its head, its crown. Thus the name. This is a female cardinal. Not the best photo, but very difficult to, when you spot a cardinal, they're very timid. A lot of birds are, but the cardinals seem to be much more timid. As soon as you spot one and try to get within range in order to begin photographing it, they usually see you. Obviously, most animals see you before you ever see them. But as soon as you start to begin to try to photograph them, they're gone. Fly away deeper into the brush. I mean, obviously, it's not impossible. There's plenty of cardinal photos out there. But you can get lucky. But this was the only one I could get of this this female. Pretty sure it's a female. Because obviously, and I'm pretty sure it's a cardinal. But it's a female because male cardinals are all red. It could be a juvenile cardinal, but I don't think so. These are black-capped chickadees. Because of the black top of their head, and then what's called a bib, black little area below the beak. Small birds. And this one is eating little, what I believe are little worms. Caterpillar. I believe there's little raised areas on the leaves. And you can see the chickadee pulling out, I believe, I'm going to say caterpillar. But you can see the raised areas on the leaf. And if that's not disease, I believe the caterpillars are inside there. So that's my amateur guess. You can see its tongue just about. And I think, like I said, I think those are caterpillars. Again, it's a best guess. It could be some kind of, I don't know what, that's causing these lesions on the leaf. Here, just as a piece of the leaf. And you'll often find, what's interesting about these birds, you'll often find them going down trees vertically. They have interesting behavior as they look in the cracks of the bark for bugs and such. Just a regular profile photo of the bird. There it is, singing or calling. Another ruby-crowned kinglet. All right, this is a series of photos. Let's see where it starts, right back here. So this is a tern. I don't know if it's just called a tern or if there's a different name for it, but so this is a tern, this is a crop. It's soaring over the marsh, looking for fish. It spots a fish, and like most of these types of birds, it darts down very quickly, splashes into the water, and comes up empty-beaked. As you can see, there's no fish in its beak. And this photo is out of order, but there you can see it just as it enters the water. And one thing I forgot to say earlier in the video, all credit to the lens and the camera, really. Anyone can take these kind of photos. This doesn't really say much about me, all right? This is a testament to the technology itself. Sure, I have to be there, and you need patience, and you need an eye for framing photos and, you know, capturing the subject. But when it comes to the clarity and the sharpness and being able to freeze time and see the subject and all of that, that's all credit to the lens and the camera. I'm just standing there holding the damn thing, pointing it, you know, just trying to remain as steady as possible. And then, you know, trying to get it against a maybe certain background, whatever, wait for the subject to not be in the busy bushes and trees so you can see it clear, the subject clear in the background or what have you. But I just push a button. You know, I just stand there, point the thing, push a button, and that's it. I mean, the camera and the lens do all the work. I'm not trying to sell myself short. But seriously, though, all credit to the lens and the camera and the technology. I have a love-hate for technology, but that's for... I've done plenty of videos about that. Anyway, so yeah. So that's the Tern. This is just in the fall, 2022, a little patch of water, a mini little pool, pond, on a path on the main tract around the reserve, and just a few different, looks like, the birds I just mentioned, the yellow-rumped warbler. You can see the yellow rump there. Might be the same type of bird over here as well. I forget how far away I was. Looks like another yellow-rumped warbler. Possibly. But different types of birds were coming, drinking out of this little mini pool of water on the path, and I just got down low with the camera and just took a bunch of different photos. Here's one that was bathing in the water. I tried to get photos of it as it was shaking its feathers, but didn't come out, or I missed that moment. Here is a catbird, very common. They're always yelling at you, quite vocal birds. Well, most birds are vocal, but catbirds always seem to be talking, I guess. But there, it's getting a drink of water. Here is a great blue heron. It was just standing there, resting, I assume, in the marsh. Kind of cold in this particular day, October 2022. You can see it's somewhat wet, so maybe it's just digesting. It must have caught quite a few fish, so I'm going to assume it's just resting, digesting. I like this particular, it's not so much I like this particular photo, but the great blue heron, like this, no matter what photo it is, just gives me this, reminds me of some kind of king, a miserable king wrapped in his, you know, kingly robes, and he's just kind of overlooking the battlefield, maybe, up high in his tower, and he's just not a very happy king, which just, I don't know, that's just kind of what it that image, or that, you know, when a great blue heron is at rest like this, just reminds me of that. Doesn't look too happy. But birds don't always look happy. You know, you look at a dog or a cat, well, dogs, when they open their mouths, seem to be happy. When they're panting, or they just have their mouth open, they seem to be smiling. I don't think cats ever look like they're smiling or happy. But birds, yeah. I don't know if birds are ever happy. If they ever feel happy and having fun. He does not look like he's having fun. That's for sure. He's probably contemplating the meaning of life. Nihilism. Maybe he's a misanthropist. Hates other birds. You never know. Or misbirthropist. Whatever. Here is a song sparrow. These are very common. You'll see them all over. This bird is just in flight. So I got very lucky. I wasn't trying to capture it in flight. It just happened to be leaving the perch, the branch it was on, and I got lucky. Most of these photos are just luck. Me just happening, just happened to be in the right place at the right time. Really, I'm like just the random wandering observer that just happens to show up, you know, and luck. That's what luck and technology, really. Just another song, the same song, sparrow, before it flew away from the branch. Another close up here is the song sparrow with its beak open, singing or calling. Basically all brown, mottled kind of bird. Very common. Again, this is down at Bombay Hook. See if I can, okay. I'm not sure which is the first in the series, but another wetland type of area, very shallow waters, plenty of fish, and again a bald eagle down on the ground hunting for fish among the marsh, the wetland. Looks like it spotted a fish, but then, or maybe it's taking a drink, but it came up. That's the largest size I have. Okay. But it came up empty-beaked. This was very far away. So this crop, the, you know, is as much as I could get cropped and zoomed in without introducing too much noise. But this is a very small portion of the original photo. These eagles were so far away. There's a main gravel road that travels through the wildlife reserve at Bombay Hook. You can just stop, get out of your car, pull over. So that's great. You don't even have to get out of your car if you don't want to. But the eagles are very far off. Most of the time. And let's start this series. Oops. So another photo of an eagle. Different one or same one. Among the marshes. Here it, you can see. It caught a small little fish. Eventually ate the fish. And then flew off to another little part of the wetland. This is a house finch. This is the type of bird that for a couple years, few years, back to back, tried to build a nest. Did build a nest in the external outside light of our garage. And then for 2 years in a row, a local hawk came and ate the babies or the eggs. next day. But yeah, so house finch. There's a couple finches, a couple finch species. There's a yellow finch. I'm not sure if that's the name, completely yellow. And then these house finches. It might be another species, might be three or four finch species. But they're almost similar to cardinals. Somewhat of a similar beak, almost red. I think there's purple finches too. Yeah, but a bit of red coloring, but they're just not as, I don't think they're as big as a cardinal. And then they have this mottled, stripy mix of brown and white, kind of like a sparrow. Let's get the first in this series here. Okay, here we go. So, again, I'm not sure if some of these photos or the rest of these photos were in that video I did in 2022, the first month with the zoom lens. So if you've been here since then and you've seen all these, sorry for going over them again, but it's winter and, you know, just looking at these photos again makes me want to go back out and pick up the hobby. This is a great egret after it caught a fish. This is all out of order. So here it is catching the fish, and it does this back and forth motion. I guess it does that to get rid of some of the mud. I don't know why it does that. That's my amateur guess. But you can see looks like it speared the fish. Okay. And then it has to flip the fish off its beak into its mouth. And I'm not sure which is before. Some of these photos are out of order. All right, so it flips it. That's what I was trying to show you with the great blue heron photos earlier. And then down the hatch. And yeah, that's it. It's before it flips it. It's kind of remarkable how an animal with no arms uses nothing but its beak as a weapon and a tool to grab the fish, and then it has to, you know, flip it off its beak into the air, and then catch it without dropping it back into the water, and then gulp it down. Kind of a strange behavior, think about it. So this is a osprey, quite common at John Heinz. John Heinz NWR. What they do is this is one. It's out of order. There's a few other photos, but they hover. They'll flap their wings to hover when they spot a fish in the water. So this osprey is like, I don't know, I would say about 8 stories, 80 feet, 100 feet above the water, something like that, very high, when it spots a fish. But a few more photos in this series, just a robin on a branch. Just happened to get a nice little clear picture of the bird on the branch with the clear background. So, not always easy to get a background like that. But yeah, American robin. Very common. with the orange or red breast, kind of orange though, auburn. These are tree swallows, very similar to barn swallows. I think the only difference is the coloring. I'm not sure what else difference between tree and barn swallows is, but definitely the coloring. Other than that, they're very similar. They will perch occasionally like this, but then fly, spend a lot of time flying around over the water, catching bugs. And same tree swallow, preening itself, scratching itself. And this is another song sparrow, which I happen to, they're, you know, most birds are quite active moving around, but this one was just perched on this branch, just singing over and over again for like 5 minutes. So I was able to capture quite a few shots of it. Here is a very close up, kind of a little peek there to the feathers on its head. And there you can see as it, another crop from the original image. But there you can see its mouth, beak open as it sings or calls. This is a blue dasher dragonfly. I believe it's a blue dasher dragonfly at rest on a, I can't think of the type of plant growing out of the marsh. But yeah, one of my favorite insects. This is a great blue heron, just in flight, moving from one location to another in its hunt for fish. Here it is after it has landed. In flight. They're like pterodactyls. I wonder if this is what pterodactyls looked like. And just another image of the great blue heron flying towards my direction. Oops. And then another with its wings, mostly horizontal. See its legs there. This, I believe, is an eastern wood peewee. They have a very interesting call or song, and I believe it's an eastern wood peewee. There's a couple of birds, two or three species, or at least two, that like these peewees. Very hard to distinguish between them, but I'm going with eastern wood peewee. I believe the same bird getting ready to fly off. Again, same bird. This is a red-winged blackbird. And it's called red-winged blackbird because of the yellow splotch on its tail feathers. No, I mean, obviously because of the red on its wing. I love how some of the birds are like, oh, we'll call it a red-winged blackbird. And then another bird will just have a weird name altogether that, you know, for whatever reason. It's like some of the, it's like so arbitrary how they come up with these names sometimes. But yeah, lots of red-winged blackbirds. They're not, the red-winged blackbirds aren't too common in suburbs or near people. They're mostly found near the wetlands or near in the woods if they're there's lots of an open area with tall grass, you'll often see or hear the red-winged blackbirds in those locations. This is just another one in flight, or the same one in flight. And this was the red-winged blackbird before it took off with a small little ladybug. And this is just a gaggle of geese, mute swans, and Canadian geese. And it's a kind of interesting how all of them, here's one just kind of chilling, resting on the surface of the water. And I find it interesting that these two species, not to mention the different birds within the species, can just all get along. There's no fighting. Maybe it's because there's plenty of fish. I don't know. But I just find it interesting. You know? Again, oh no, I believe this is a house wren. It looks very similar to the peewee, but I believe the shape or the form of the tail feathers and then the beak gives it makes the difference why this is a house wren. And if you hear any funny noise in the background, it's not my stomach. Actually, the video card fan keeps starting up and then stopping. Anyway, yeah, so now there is an app you can use on your phone to identify birds, either a picture of a bird or the sound, called Merlin ID. Now, I don't use it for the sound or the picture, because I'm walking around with my camera, not my phone, and many of these birds are far away. I could use it for the sound, but the problem is, I lost the hearing in my left ear. So I have one ear, and my directional audio doesn't exist. So when I hear a sound, I don't know which direction it's coming from. So I can't rely on sound to direct me to the location of a bird. And when I do see a bird, I'm taking a photo of it, and I'm not thinking about, let me pull out my phone and, you know, take some audio to identify it. I always forget about it. I'm more interested in taking the photos of the behaviors or the bird. And the identification is somewhat important, but not so much to me. So same, what I believe is a house wren, just turning its head so you can get a nice little profile shot of it. And then the bird leaning over, looking at something, who knows what. And there it is, singing or calling. Here's a pair of, I just love the look of the closed beak on this particular bird. It's like, just, you know, what are you looking at? Kind of a expression. A pair of barn swallows, similar to the barn swallow, beginning of the video that was on that green plant. This pair just happens to be chilling, vibing on a branch. They were there for like 5 or 10 minutes. Now, I don't know if they're like young barn swallows, if they're, I believe they're two males. Could be a male and female, I don't know. But I just found it interesting that there's a pair of them together. Two males, apparently, maybe brothers, I don't know. Usually birds are very somewhat solitary when they're out and about. You don't really see them in pairs, except for like starlings, crows. You'll see some male and female birds together, like mourning doves and cardinals. But I don't really know too much about barn swallows, but I just kind of found it interesting. A pair of them just together on a branch. And again, same pair. This one with its mouth open, apparently calling, chirping. Same pair. One of them preening. And then both of them looking at you or us. Like, okay, can you, like, you know, get enough photos now? Leave us alone. Kind of a blurry photo of a green darner. What I believe is a green darner dragonfly in flight at quite a distance away. Very hard for the camera to focus on with the water in the background, so sometimes the camera will focus on the water just beneath the dragonfly, which is why the dragonfly's head and body kind of out of focus there. Looks like the focus is in the back. Here is another photo where the front of the dragonfly is a little more in focus. A little bit in focus there as well as the wings move. And then one more photo. Yep, you can see its legs tucked in there. Here is a green heron, smaller version of the great blue heron. This is the first time I've ever photographed and seen one of these. This was at a bit of a distance among the marsh. And it has a little bit of a green tint to its feathers, maybe on the back of its head as well. Other than that, very similar to the great blue heron in design. There's another picture of it. Doesn't quite have the long neck of the great blue heron. I'm not sure if this is a adult green heron or a young one. I don't really know, but you could see here in the foreground lots of reeds, so it was in this little area, like a pond type area with lots of reeds all around, so very difficult to get a clear shot of it. Another little photo, you can see its foot there as it walks among the marsh, and a profile shot, a little overexposed. This is a downy woodpecker, quite common in the area where I live, and it's black and white kind of spots on its wings, and a bit of a stripe look, going black and white stripe kind of look on its head. And that is the downy woodpecker. There's three types of the downy. The other two have red. One is a very large. This here, the downy woodpecker, somewhat small, like a little bit bigger than a cardinal, not the size of a crow, I don't think. No. And then there's another woodpecker that has some red on it. And then there's a much larger woodpecker whose head is completely red. And that large woodpecker is like the size of a hawk, almost. I think it's larger than a crow, around that range. So, yeah, that's a, now that's actually something I should try to go out and photograph. They're very difficult. There's only that's a lot of walking around, pure luck, trying to take a photo of them. But yeah, so, downy woodpecker. And I think I might have shown this in that video I did 2 years ago, but here is a red-winged blackbird or a crow, I don't know, as it attacks a female or young male eagle. So I just find it interesting. You'll always see crows chasing hawks from either its area or where its nest might be. But happens quite frequently. This is the first time I've ever seen a crow or a red-winged blackbird, probably a crow, chasing an eagle. That looks like a crow. I don't know, probably a crow. And there you can see the crow right on the tail feathers of the eagle, landing there probably for a brief moment, using its crow feet to somewhat attack the eagle. And there they are, both flying away from each other. Oh, it is a red-winged blackbird after all. So, okay. Picture of a bumblebee nectaring whatever type of flower that is. You can see its tongue right out there. Tongue is like a straw, I believe. Just a side profile. And there it is, just a lucky shot of the bumblebee taking off or landing. Can't remember. And there it is again. Better shot of the tongue as it drinks up the nectar. Here is a lucky shot of a pair of dragonflies. I think they're brown with a touch of yellow, so I should know the name, but I forget. Anyway, they are a mating pair, and the female is depositing eggs into the water. Now, she may have previously mated, and this is a new male trying to mate. I don't really know. But they were attached for quite a while. And I believe she would go up and down, laying eggs. Just another shot. I believe this is a yellow warbler. Not the golden finch that is up in the area where I live. Side profile of that, all yellow with a little touch of brown here and there. This was at Bombay Hook. A few adult Canadian geese with some, you might say, teenage, younger Canadian geese. This one was just shaking off the water. Oops. Here's two. There's about five or six of these older geese. Older young geese. This is a mourning dove that was just resting, perched on this branch, didn't really move much. These are somewhat timid birds. They can be not the best photo because of the branch, you know, blocking out the bird, and it's an underneath shot. I prefer to, you know, get a better shot than this, but it was an awkward angle. best shot I could get. And this, another series here of another great egret, as it darts its beak into the water to catch a fish. You can see its beak, lower beak, speared the fish. Another close-up view there. This must have been before or after. I think this is before, when it spies the fish. And then I don't think, yeah. Just a different angle. No photo, I don't think, of eating the fish. And some kind of wasp nectaring this flower. A flock of mute swans flying here is what I believe a female American red start. Don't know how they come up with these names sometimes. But you can see some of these birds are very difficult to identify because of the yellow between the breast and the wing. Yellow on the tail. Some yellow on the wing. Not to mention the overall color. Somewhat similar. I believe it's a female American red start. Or a male American red start. I don't know if it's female because of the coloring. But I did my best to identify it. I don't think it's a yellow-rumped warbler. No. I think same picture of the same bird preening itself. Another picture. Different angle. And there it is. Looking for something above or below. Here is a very lucky shot of a hummingbird. This hummingbird was perched on this branch in the sunny part of the mostly a tree-covered area, little path that walks through the John Heinz Wildlife Refuge, and I just happened to spot it, and I don't know if at first I thought it was a hummingbird, but I think I eventually realized it, so I tried to, you know, try to get close and get set up to take photos of it, and then eventually it took off. But that's the first time I've seen a hummingbird, second time actually, a hummingbird without having a feeder. I don't feed birds, we don't feed birds or have a feeder. So this is only the second time I've ever seen a hummingbird naturally in the environment. And I think here's the same hummingbird. I remember just seeing a bird perched at the end of the branch when I was looking around. And this might have been, and then I walked further down the path, and then I saw the hummingbird that we just saw perched on a different branch. So I think this was before. Honeybee nectaring the same type of purple flower. This is a common tern, I believe. Just vibing, chilling. It landed down onto the water. I think it took a drink. I'm not sure. that's kind of all I was doing, floating around. Here's a groundhog in a tree. I don't know why it was in a tree. Maybe it got scared or something. Never seen a groundhog in a tree. So, or I don't think that's a beaver. I think it's a groundhog. It was in the tree before I showed up, so don't know why it was in there. Here's a orb weaver that was building its web. The lens that I use is on a monopod with a swivel head. If I had a tripod, this would have been great to set up so I could have done time lapse of the orb weaver as it went around and around building its web. But this, I believe, is a warbling vireo. And you can see it caught a little spider there in its beak. These are the kind of moments that I love to capture, these behaviors, feeding behaviors especially. So the previous photo was a crop. This is a crop of the original, but just to give you an idea how far away the bird was, and just another photo, a little clearer, of the spider about to be a meal. Another photo. Okay. Here are two red-bellied woodpeckers. That's the word. These are a little bit bigger than the downy woodpecker, but not quite as big as the larger woodpecker with the full red kind of head. This is like, unless these are male downy woodpeckers, and the other one we saw was a female. I don't know, I'm confused now with my woodpeckers. But yeah, there were one male and then another male showed up. And I don't really know what was going on, but just took a photo. It was at quite of a distance, and this is a crop, so a little bit blurry there. And there they both are. I'm not sure if they're in the middle of a fight or what, over territory. Don't know. Here is a female wood duck, or a male wood duck. No, I think it's a female. The male wood duck would be much more colorful, and I think it's the ducklings that usually follow the female. All ducklings are usually cute. Kind of hard to see here, but right here, towards the lower part of the photo, just a side angle of the ducks among whatever types of plants these are growing out of the wetland. Here's a kind of a close-up of the female wood duck, unless it's a male. Another shot of the wood duck and his or her babies. Another photo there, and here is a snapping turtle, a very large turtle. And here is that brown dragonfly with a touch of yellow, the female depositing eggs. This is at quite a distance, so this sharpness and clarity, that's all the camera. You can see the tail right there touching into the water. And here's the same dragonfly, but another dragonfly passing by. the same dragonfly again. And this, I believe, is a marsh wren. They are among the reeds and cattails. Very interesting bird. As you can see here, they grab onto the reeds and the cattail, and they'll perch there and do their singing and calling in that position. I've just never seen a bird do this before. Usually you see them perched on a horizontal branch, but to see a bird perched like this, it's kind of interesting behavior. Different shot there. Rear shot. There you can see its beak open as it sings or calls. House sparrow. And yeah, some cormorants, and we're gonna finish up the video here. Just go through here a little bit. Most of these photos were shown. Yeah, these photos were mostly shown in that video I did, 2022. This is a bluebird, just happened to catch a caterpillar in its beak. Looks like a mustache. This was taken at Tyler Arboretum, which is why you see a bird box there. Bluebird. Bluebirds are quite common where I live. More bluebirds. Blue jay in the backyard. Love blue jays. Such a beautiful bird. Kind of a regal look and appearance to them. And that's gonna do it. Pretty much. These are older photos. That's a great egret and a snowy egret. The snowy egret is much smaller. This is a common yellow throat. You see, a lot of these birds look so very similar. I think it's a common yellow throat. All these warblers and whatnot, small birds look so very similar. You can see it there stretching out, using its wings to balance. So it tries to get whatever it is there on that branch. Reaching out again, maybe seeing what's ever at the tip of that branch. Eating a bug or a seed. This is an eastern kingbird. And then a male and female eagle, maybe a juvenile male. The juvenile showed up, or the female. They started to kind of have a little scuffle, but then that was it. And we'll just do the final photos here. This is an osprey. Where's the first? There we go. Oh, and this is a cedar waxwing. What's kind of special about this photo, I happened to walk down a different path that I didn't take before, see where it led me. And there's this tree, a dead tree, I think. I think this was October 2022, can't remember. And this bird was just sitting there, never seen a bird quite like it. And I believe it's a cedar waxwing. I think it's kind of rare. Don't know what it sounds like. It was quiet. And then there's its, a couple photos of it. Yeah, so cedar waxwing. But back to the osprey. Again, this is what they do, kind of hover. Very angelic looking, but they hover in the air. When they spot a fish, this is right after it dove down into the water. At this point, here it has the fish in its claws. You can see it lifting itself up out of the water with the fish. There's another shot with its claws into the fish. Another shot there. These are the kind of behavior photos that I love to capture. Just barely has the fish in the one claw as it flies away. So, that'll do it. So thank you very much for tuning in. And, you know, if you are new to photography, you know, I wish you all the best and of success with the hobby and whatever it is, nature, wildlife, or architecture, whatever kind of photography it might be. Hope it brings you lots of, you know, joy, you know, while it lasts. I don't know if you're like me, and these hobbies come and go, but, or if you're looking to get into photography, you know, hopefully you'll find some fun and enjoyment out of that. And yeah, stay tuned for my photography for beginners. Other than that, again, thanks for joining. It was great having you here. And I wish you all my best. Hope to see you in another video real soon. Until then,